As global warming slowly continues its course, it becomes increasingly evident that another serious problem is looming on the horizon of our already precarious situation. Yes, we're talking about the major environmental devastations caused by increasingly frequent and anomalous weather systems, such as periods of drought followed by severe floods or sudden and out-of-season temperature fluctuations. These unpredictable oscillations, which in certain regions of the globe lead from one extreme climate to another, are symptomatic of a phenomenon whimsically named the climate whiplash, which experts believe will become more pronounced as temperatures rise. Global warming is undoubtedly the cause, but the mechanism behind it is thought to be the breakdown of the structure now known as the polar vortex, under the blows also brought by El Niño and La Niña, the two oceanic currents that influence ocean temperatures. When stable, the polar vortex produces a normal and seasonal climate. However, an unstable vortex causes abnormal and extreme weather conditions. The discovery of this mechanism leads us to make predictions about the temperatures of the current winter season, but above all, about those summers that will follow. A summer that, according to many, will be so hot that the adjective infernal will be considered an understatement in many regions of the world. And yet, as you'll understand at the end of this video, there are still some who are convinced that it will be the polar vortex itself that will soon bring our planet to the brink of yet another ice age. Aren't you curious to know why? Okay, we get it. Glaciers are melting, sea levels are rising, forests are dying, and wildlife is going extinct at a rate of at least 1,000 species per year. The cause of this has long been defined as global warming, which, to say the least, would make it seem like a unique phenomenon with homogeneous effects across our entire planet. In reality, in recent years, it has become apparent that this upheaval manifests itself in different forms from place to place, even occurring in entirely contradictory ways. So much so that for some time now, people have preferred to talk about climate change rather than global warming. But wait a minute. Regardless of the name we want to give it, can we really be sure that this phenomenon is real and actually happening? Well, it seems so, although many doubts persist. For many decades, thousands of scientists have studied the planet's climatology over the past millennia, reaching an overwhelming consensus that the Earth is warming and that human use of fossil fuels is the main cause of this warming. To understand how such unanimity of judgment has been reached, it is important first to know the main forces that influence the climate. The greatest ones are those from the sun, whose energy can fluctuate over time, ocean circulation, which influences how heat is distributed around the planet, volcanic activity, which pumps material into the sky that can have warming or cooling effects, and the overall amount of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Each of these forces has played an important role at different times in history. For example, 56 million years ago, a massive amount of greenhouse gases from volcanoes or past methane deposits, or both, suddenly warmed the planet by at least 10 degrees Celsius, triggering mass extinctions. About 18,000 years ago, significant changes in Atlantic Ocean circulation instead plunged the Northern Hemisphere into the Ice Age that accompanied our species throughout the entire Paleolithic era. And 300 years ago, a combination of reduced solar activity and increased volcanic activity cooled some regions of the planet enough to allow Londoners to regularly skate on the frozen Thames during the so-called Little Ice Age. In studying the cause of today's climate changes, scientists have examined all these factors, ruling out the first three, solar energy, oceanic patterns, and volcanic activity, which they believe have remained normal over the past 150 years. They have identified the increase in carbon dioxide, the quintessential greenhouse gas, as the culprit for all woes. But what are greenhouse gases? Similar to what happens in a greenhouse, shortwave solar rays easily penetrate the atmosphere, reaching much of the Earth's surface, where they are partly deflected and partly absorbed by the surface and converted into heat. The heat is then dissipated into space in the form of infrared radiation, but not entirely. Some gases prevent certain wavelengths of infrared emissions from dispersing into outer space. Thus, excess heat accumulates, further warming the atmosphere. The main greenhouse gas is carbon dioxide, It is the primary exhaust gas produced by the combustion of fossil fuels such as coal and oil, and accounts for about 4/5 of the greenhouse gases emitted by human activities. Methane from oil and gas production in other sources is the second most abundant. It has a greater heat-trapping capacity than carbon dioxide, but persists in the atmosphere for a shorter time. That said, greenhouse gas levels have fluctuated throughout Earth's history, but have remained fairly constant over the past few thousand years. Similarly, global average temperatures remained stable until the advent of the industrial era, which, through the use of fossil fuels, has increased carbon dioxide by 50%. Studying ancient air bubbles trapped in ice, scientists know that before 1750, the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was about 280 parts per million. That number is now above 420 parts per million. With the rise in the mercury column, climate changes can take unexpected turns, and even the most orthodox climatologists are forced to admit that human activity is not the only factor capable of influencing Earth's climate. As we have already mentioned, volcanic eruptions and changes in solar radiation also play a role, albeit secondary, in global warming, as do relatively recently discovered natural phenomena such as the polar vortex and ocean currents called El Niño and La Niña. So a very strange fact is emerging. According to the National Centers for Environmental Information, the frequency of extreme snowstorms has increased in 2/3 of the eastern United States. And despite rising average temperatures, there has also been a significant increase in bouts of intense cold. This data is specific to the United States, but researchers say similar effects are being observed in other parts of the world. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. But why? What could explain this apparent climatic contradiction, where a planet that is getting warmer also produces sudden ice storms? To answer, we must first consider two other natural forces, the polar vortex, which we have already mentioned, and the ocean currents, El Niño and La Niña, which in the original sense of the term represent two different warm ocean currents that periodically appear along the coasts of Ecuador and Peru, disrupting local fishing. El Niño and La Niña influence atmospheric circulation and precipitation, causing different climatic effects in various parts of the world. In general, El Niño leads to drier and warmer conditions in some areas, such as Australia, Indonesia, and South America, and wetter and cooler conditions in other areas, such as North America and Europe. La Niña, on the other hand, brings opposite conditions, with more rain and cold in some areas, and more drought and heat in others. The polar vortex, on the other hand, is a large area of low pressure and cold air that forms in the autumn, consolidates in the winter, and dissipates in the spring. All this is in the stratosphere between 10 and 50 kilometers of altitude. During winter, when temperatures at the pole become extremely cold, the air contracts and generates a vortex. This vortex tends to strengthen with the arrival of polar darkness, becoming a dominant feature of the winter stratosphere. The strength and stability of the vortex can vary from year to year, and these variations have a direct impact on weather in mid-latitudes, influencing, for example, the intensity and position of the jet stream, the high-speed air current that separates polar cold air from the milder air of mid-latitudes. Well, recently, we have noticed that this vortex does not maintain its characteristics for long. One of the main forces influencing the strength and direction of the vortex is that unleashed by the so-called planetary waves, also known as Rossby waves. These waves are large disturbances that can transfer energy and heat between different regions of the globe, altering wind flow and pressure. When these waves reach the stratosphere, they can interact with the vortex, transferring energy and angular momentum. If these waves are strong enough, they can disrupt the vortex structure or move it from its normal circular pattern. This can have significant repercussions on the climate of mid-latitudes, leading, for example, to particularly cold winters in some regions like North America and Europe. However, the most interesting thing is apparently these phenomena are all interconnected. El Niño and La Niña can alter the shape and intensity of planetary waves, which in turn can influence the stability and position of the polar vortex. In particular, El Niño tends to favor the vortex's breakdown, especially in late season, while La Niña tends to strengthen it. Experts say that one of the causes of the climatic whip effect could be precisely this: the weakening of jet streams, which, lacking strength, can no longer prevent the cold air of the vortex from escaping and spreading southward. Based on all these factors, which we have only recently begun to consider together, for the winter of 2023-2024, experts predict a significant change in the behavior of the polar vortex, with a potential expansion towards Europe, where it could bring colder weather and snowstorms. In the United States, on the other hand, an increase in mild air masses is expected due to the influence of El Niño. To be fair, we must certify the fact that at the moment, and we are at the end of February, the exact opposite is happening with mild temperatures in Europe and waves of extreme cold in the USA, and especially in Canada, where temperatures have reached minus 40 degrees Celsius. However, winter's not over yet, and there's still maybe some formidable tailwinds. It's best to wait and see. This is what is predicted for the current winter season, but it is in the summer months that 2024 could prove to be either an unforgettable year or not. According to hundreds of experts, in fact, in 2024, the world could witness an unprecedented climatic event which could have catastrophic consequences for the climate and life on Earth. According to latest forecasts, 2024 could see a very strong El Niño event, which could set a record for global average warmth and bring the planet closer than ever to a warming threshold that scientists and policymakers warn could be potentially harmful. According to some estimates, 2024 could indeed be the first year in which the global temperature exceeds 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, a threshold considered critical to avoid the most severe impacts of climate change. This means that starting this summer, the world could experience irreversible effects such as the melting of polar ice, rising sea levels, ocean acidification, and the loss of biodiversity. Is this the classic beginning of the end? To many, it would seem so, but we must never forget one fact. All forecasts are built on hundreds of mathematical models, in turn constructed on equations with hundreds of variables, stuff to even make Nostradamus pale. In short, nothing of what is being said about the planet's future climate can or should be taken seriously. This is a golden rule that should be applied to short-term forecasts, let alone those concerning a distant future. A future in which we're talking about a few decades at most, some predict that the polar vortex could even trigger a mini ice age. This prediction is based on the hypothesis that the cooling of the North Atlantic caused by the breakdown of the polar vortex may increasingly interfere with the ocean current system that transports heat to and from the polar regions. If this system were to stop, the average temperatures in the northern hemisphere could drop by several degrees, leading to a climate similar to that which occurred during the Little Ice Age between the 14th and 19th centuries. Try to imagine a scenario where, as a result of this cooling, heavy snowfall resumes. The abundance of such snowfall can create conditions where summer fails to melt completely, thus forming the first permanent snow cover. These snow extensions will reflect sunlight to a greater extent, which, no longer heating the surface, will further cool it. This cooling will not have immediate consequences at equatorial latitudes, where the cold cannot affect the warmth of the oceans, laden with high amounts of vapor. In subsequent winters, it will always be the high humidity that will lead to abundant snowfalls, triggering, year after year, the initial phase of glaciation. After a few decades, the extent of the icy territories will have reached a consistency that will allow them to begin the conquest of more southern territories, gradually cooling the oceans and freezing the northern land masses. Rainfall and sea levels will decrease with a consequent drop in evaporation. The decrease in sea levels will expose land surfaces to erosion. Nutrients and other minerals will be introduced into the ocean, increasing the productivity of calcite-covered phytoplankton. Since phytoplankton production works like photosynthesis and absorbs carbon dioxide, the oceans will therefore increase their absorption of the latter. Carbon dioxide will also be reduced in the atmosphere due to the amount retained by the glaciers. At this point, the development of the ice surfaces would have reached such positions to the south as to limit their advance. This is both due to the lack of further snow supply, which cannot fall because the oceans will have cooled too much and there will be no longer air circulations to provoke it, and because sunlight, having easier access, will begin to melt the last extensions of ice again. The weight of the ice will also sink the rocky layers, lowering them in turn. The combined effects of these processes can be considered the beginning of the second part of the cycle. In this phase, the large ice masses will tend to feed back. The gradual melting of the southernmost ice areas with the rapid fragmentation of the large ice masses will again to form lakes and rivers. The sea level will gradually rise again. Carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, together with methane released from dead plant matter in swamps, will return to normal levels, recreating the greenhouse effect that will lead to a new warming of the planet, this time much more contained than what we are expecting in these years. The consequences of these processes will again bring about thawing and the reappearance, with the necessary modifications, of the lands as they were before the cycle. In short, current warming, especially if it were to become even more significant in the coming years, by the end of the century could trigger a completely opposite process. So according to supporters of the theory of a planet capable of self-regulating and correcting sudden environmental changes, global warming will eventually stop and we will gradually experience a new ice age, more or less intense but still icy. This will be followed by a moderate warming and the attainment of a new balance. Will it really be like that? What do you guys think?